The Spanish historian Palencia, who said that the Reconquista was nothing but a civil war between Spaniards of two different faiths.
Spain is full of dazzling reminders of how the righteous Christians won the country back from the diabolical Moor. The country's most popular saint is called Santiago Matamoros, St. James, the Moor Slayer. But this romanticized version of history distorts the true nature of this conflict. This was not a holy war. Al-Andalus was destroyed in a dirty grab for land, which lasted for over 300 years. And in this conflict, the more refined society was the one least equipped for war. It was the Christians who had little to lose and most to gain. And what happened when the Christians began to take over exposes a curious respect for Muslim culture. When the Christian King Peter took control of Seville in 1248, this is what he had made. It is a beautiful building. It was built for a Christian, and yet in every way it resembles an Islamic palace. On the walls there are inscriptions from the Quran, and above the door there are dedications to its owner, calling him Caliph rather than king.
The conqueror has been conquered by the culture.
It's a tiny bit unexpected that when this Christian king rebuilt this palace, he made it appear so Arabic. It feels as if we're in the Alhambra here.
Well, this palace has many relations with the Alhambra, especially with the Court of Lions. Both builders, King Muhammad V of Granada and King Peter I of Castile, were friends. You have to consider that in Europe, at this time, there was not an architecture of such a splendor comparable to Al-Andalus. And this made a very big attraction for the Christians. And this is why this architecture was used by the Christian to show to the nobility of the kingdom the power, the authority, this room covered with this marvelous dome. It symbolized a power, because it's the heavens that turns around the king.
But the legacy of Al-Andalus was to affect more than the architecture of Europe. In the midst of this terrible struggle, something incredible was to happen, which would fire the minds of Europeans and expand our intellectual horizons. At the same time that it was being splintered by Christian encroachment, Al-Andalus was at the centre of one of the most influential shifts in thinking that Europe has ever seen. Between the Middle Ages and the modern era, Europe underwent a massive intellectual and cultural revolution. This shift, known as the Renaissance, transformed the human experience. It prompted the exploration of science and the arts and changed the way that men and women saw themselves in relation to God. The Renaissance and the scientific revolution that followed were critical stages in the development of Europe. The origins of the Renaissance are generally believed to lie in Italy, where a renewed interest in the classics had a huge impact on art and culture. But the foundations of the Renaissance were laid much earlier and not in Italy, but in a town called Toledo in Islamic Spain. Toledo was one of Al-Andalus's vulnerable city-states, and in 1085, the Christians seized control of it. Unusually, the handover went very smoothly, and as a result, the Muslims already living in Toledo were allowed to remain as citizens and their mosques were left untouched. The city that emerged accommodated both Muslim and Christian.
Spain at this time is a paradox. On one hand, tensions between Muslims and Christians are becoming unbearable. And yet, on the other, there is a hugely beneficial intellectual evolution that is only possible because Muslims and Christians are living side by side.
When Toledo fell to the Christians, its doors were opened to travellers and intellectuals from all over Europe. These people mixed with the Muslims in the city, learning their language and reading their books. Many of the adventurers came from England.
In the late 1100s, an Englishman known as Daniel of Morley travelled to Europe to study. But as his autobiography reveals, he was disgusted with what he found there. I stopped a while in Paris, and there I saw asses rather than men, pretending to be very important. They had desks in front of them, heaving under the weight of two or three immovable tomes. But because they did not know anything, they were no better than marble statues. I did not want to get infected by a similar petrification. But when I heard that the doctrine of the Arabs was in fashion in Toledo, I hurried there as quickly as I could so that I could hear the wisest philosophers in the world.
Just as the fall of Alexandria had made a massive body of Greek knowledge available to the Arabs 400 years previously, now the Christian conquest of Toledo passed this storehouse of knowledge on to Europeans, who flocked here in their hundreds.
At the backs of shops and in courtyards, groups of men started to gather together, Christians, Muslims and Jews, to work on texts that had been stored in the archives of mosques and churches. These were extraordinary manuscripts, translations of Aristotle and Plato and Euclid, as well as original works by Arabic mathematicians, astronomers and alchemists. This was a resource like no other in the rest of Europe. It was intellectual dynamite.
People came from all over Europe. All these works that were lost in Europe could be found in Toledo. There was lots of wisdom here.
How did the translators work together here in Toledo?
In the first period, there was usually two people working together. And then another person who was learned in Latin would write it down in Latin. And that was, I think, the target of working together, and it was very clear. I think it really made it more accurate because it was a teamwork.
How long have these manuscripts been kept in Toledo?
Well, most of the translations were carried out in the 12th and 13th century. That means for almost 900 years, most of them. And here we have the preface in red. That's where we learn about the process of translation. In this case, we read that this book was translated by Gerard of Cremona. It is a medical treatise by Ibn Sina, by Avicenna, and it was translated ab Arabico, from Arabic, in Latinum, into Latin, in Toledo.
Yeah. It's a very rich document, isn't it? You get a sense of how valued these things were.
And there's all these little glosses on the right-hand side. People have been adding comments or explaining words that were not clear. Un momento, por favor.
Vamos a... Wow, that's a splendid beast of a thing.
Yeah.